Opening statements, introductions. Let's go ahead and introduce everybody to begin with. We have Diane Richards.
Just
introduce yourself.
Hi, everybody. Diane Richards from Hayfork.
Hayfork District 5, and you're running for?
Treasurer, tax collector.
Thank you.
I'm Terry McBrayer, treasurer, tax collector. And I'm Weaverville.
I'm Mark Bonds, current deputy sheriff, running for the position of sheriff, and I'm out of Weaverville.
Corporal Ron Hanover, work for the sheriff's office. Live in Hayfork.
Tim Saxon, candidate for sheriff, Weaverville.
Karen Zepini, candidate for clerk, recorder, assessor, and I live in Hayfork.
Lisa Wright, I live in Lewiston, and I'm a candidate for the clerk, recorder, assessor.
Shanna White, I'm the current county clerk, recorder, assessor, and I live in Lewiston.
Okay, thank you all for remembering your names. I know. Gonna move on to our opening statements. We're gonna start with treasurer, tax collector, and gonna give you 2 minutes. Yeah, hold on. 2 minutes, and is there a preference of who starts? Between the two of you, you want a coin flip, or you want me to choose? I wouldn't pick Diane. Okay, Diane, you're up. Go ahead. No, you can stay right there. You can stand if you want. Or sit there.
And before they start, John, do you want me to collect cards? You want to mention about the cards and the papers to spill out?
There's cards and the paper in the back for questions. Somebody has questions?
Yes.
Okay, let's go through the opening statements. Diane is ready, and we'll get Terry's next. And then I'll grab some cards, and they're going to have a chance to talk for a couple of
Sandy minutes. Could collect them while they're talking.
Oh. Okay, Sandy's been in charge of this before then. Thank you, Diane, for being patient with us. Go ahead.
Hi, everybody, and thank you for coming. I'm running for a treasurer tax collector. I'm a rancher and a businesswoman in Hayfork, and also I have a business, an automotive business in San Francisco, a family business. I do have quite a bit of experience in business and actually in banking. I was the protege of a gentleman that actually developed branch banking, and he taught me a lot about investment a long time ago. Never thought that I'd really use it. But I've been very interested in our finances of the county, and I attempted an internal audit, citizens audit, myself, an independent audit, and I was stymied by the county council, basically. I found many things that were basically red flags. I had a franchise tax board auditor, retired, but one of the top auditors assisting me with the documents I got, and that person told me that there were a lot of red flags, an incredible amount of red flags. We've seen some things in other departments, misuse and misappropriation of funds in many different departments. The treasurer actually controls all the monies that come in, the state and federal mandate funds, as well as the district funding, and is responsible for dispersing that to the auditor to be let out through warrants or checks. So they have control of the cash and the investments of the county. When I looked at the investments, I saw that nothing's changed for a long time in many of our investments. One of our investments, for instance, is a French company that we have $2 million invested in. We only get about 1% back from them. We've had it since 1992. Nothing has changed. The audits that we're doing are not the external audits that auditors are coming in are finding nothing other than negative cash balances and some managerial problems. But there are other issues that people brought up to me with the treasurer's office, and I felt that I should run. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
For those of you that don't know me, my name is Terry McBrayer. I'm your current beloved treasurer tax collector. I love where I live. I love my community, and I'm dedicated to making this county great. I've held this position since 2009. My finance and banking experience spans over 20 years. I hold a bachelor's degree in accounting with an emphasis in business administration. I'm credentialed California County Senior Executive for CSEC. I'd like to make you aware of how I approached my life and my position. I research and I gather the facts to be well-informed on any particular issue to ensure that I have a full picture and I understand all the ramifications, and also taking into consideration all the respective laws, codes, regulations before coming to a decision. I am a facts-based person. I will not give you information simply because I think that's what you want to hear. I will provide you with the facts and the truth of any matter at hand. I have an awesome team who makes the efforts that we put in a success. They're like a second family, and they deserve lots of kudos for all their hard work. We survived the turmoil when the state decided to issue the county IOUs. We endured the housing market crash when the bubble burst, and we withstood the sustained near zero interest rate environment without any detrimental effects. It's the caring, committed people that make us a superb team. We realize that paying taxes is not something that everyone wants to do. I don't really know why, but our team does try to make it a pleasant experience, you know, with good customer service. If you happen to visit us around a major holiday or a deadline, you'll find that we decorate the office. We provide goodies for our visitors. We try to make it a welcoming environment. We even added a fish tank to our lobby. The goodies in the fish tanks, of course, are paid for out of our personal funds. You know, feel free to stop by and say hi and see, you know, see the fish tank and pay your taxes. As far as fund balances and things of that sort, again, those are not pertaining to our, that's not a treasurer function. But I'd like to, I am the candidate with education experience that you can rely on.
Thank you very much. I have some questions. There's guys have been working out there furiously, or else y'all brought them with you. Okay. Let's start with this one. Let's start with Terry on this one, since you're precious talking. What is your governmental budgeting experience?
I have been in the office since 2007, so I've prepared budgets since then. I have multiple departments that I budget, not just treasurer, tax collector, but by code. There are other departments that I'm required to budget as well. We are a general fund department, so I have some revenues that we bring in, but we are reliant on the general fund to bring some of those in, so I'm required to work with them on a budget that I do have, so I have lots of experience that way.
Okay, Diane, what is your governmental budgeting experience?
Well, I don't budget in the government because I've never held a government position. However, when I was doing my audit, I worked with the auditor, the prior auditor, Marilyn Horn, and I asked her for the CAFR, which is a comprehensive annual financial report. It was very difficult to get it. The county council was refusing me to have it, which is the truth. The budget is sort of a fantasy, whereas the CAFR is the real statement of the status of all the accounts in the government. And I finally found it, and in there, for instance, and it's a very complicated document, by the way, I found in there that there was a certificate of participation, but they sell it like as it was a municipal bond, in which they removed our ownership of the courthouse and the detention center, and they never spoke about it in the Board of Supervisors, and I was very shocked when I found it in there. I did meet with Terry. I asked to meet with her because she was on the committee for that, and I said, you know, this is illegal that they put these certificate of participation funds, there was like $4.5 million, into the general fund. If they take it out on that building, the law is that it is to be used for renovations or parking lots. They completely dumped it in there, and those money should have never been released for them to dump into the general fund. So, even though I don't have the experience, I can read law and I can read books. Thank you.
Thank you, Diane. This is specifically for Terry. What has your department done under your leadership to make it easier for the public to access records and pay taxes? I know you answered this a little bit in your opening statement, but if you want to.
We've been a bit of a, in the archaic stages in the way of, our systems are a bit older, and so we don't have some of the capabilities with our tax software. But one of the things that I have done is I have created where we are able to pay. You can pay your taxes online. That's also something that I've done for many county departments. They can now accept credit cards as well. We have, my door's always open, so if someone wants to meet with me, they're more than welcome. I've done that for lots of taxpayers to come in and meet with me. We are in the process of doing some additional updates so that that, again, is making it more user-friendly for the taxpayers.
Okay. And Diane, this is a little different here. It's for you specifically. Over the past few years, you have worked or you've dealt with the county. I'm condensing this down a little bit for you. And you've created some animosity and distrust within the county. How, in order to work with in harmony with our other elected officials, how do you plan to sidestep or move around? I can read the rest of it if you want, a little bit more specific.
Well, basically, I am a person that has goals, and I want to get to the point. I attended Board of Supervisor meetings, and I brought up things, for instance, like the CalPERS, the Certificate of Participation. I bring it up to the Board of Supervisors. They ask for them to work with me. They refuse to do that. So I don't know about the animosity, except for you only get 3 minutes to talk about these very important issues. They never put you on the agenda when you request it. I've worked with, for instance, the auditor, both auditors, and we're able to get. I was able to get lots of good information and cooperation. I was even on a safety team in the sheriff's department when Sheriff Haney was originally put into place. So, and I was on the Trinity Collaborative. The number one project in this force was the one that I proposed, and there was about 200 people in that collaborative when we started. So there were a lot of personalities from environmentalists to timber guys, etc. And I was able to get into the middle and reach an agreement that we could all really live with to make our force more fire resilient. So I have a lot of skills at that, but I need to have the cooperation from the other side to work with me. That now, if, as treasurer, they would be forced to work with me and deal with some of the things, for instance, like our CalPERS, etc., that we really need to look at. And they need to realize that we need to be more serious about our finances. Thank you.
Thank you, and this is for both of you. Let's go. Diane, do you mind taking this one on? Please explain how property taxes are generated.
Well, generated. Generally, they assess your property, and there's many different ways that they're supposed to use. They're supposed to look at new building and what have you comes in from the planning department. One of the problems in our county, I'm glad you asked the question, is that they're not assessing properly the corporations that have possessory property, for instance, if they have towers and all the lines that PG&E runs, they're supposed to assess that. And the state auditor who comes in sometimes every 4 or 5 years to audit the assessor's office to see how they're auditing, how they're doing the assessments, has said they've been remiss at that. So we could generate more funds that way. But what they have found also is that the ones that should be not being charged as much, for instance, like trailers, they should depreciate, and they have found them appreciating. They also found that they were also charging them the inflationary rate way over what they're supposed to. So we have actually, all of us, have been paying too much. It might not be that much. For some people, it should be a lot less than others. But we should not have, for years this has been going on, that they've been overcharging us. Thank you.
Please explain how property taxes are generated.
I believe the question was, like, as you said, how are property taxes generated? So in answer to that question, it would depend on the type of taxes that you're speaking to, but taxes are generated. They originate starting with the assessor's office. So the assessor's office would be presented with the valuation. In regards to valuations, the assessor's office, again, is required by law. There are certain, depending on the type of tax that they have, for instance, if I purchase a house for $500,000 and that price is at market value of $500,000, then guess what? I'm going to be marketed at that $500,000. However, if for some reason I did not turn in what I should have and they say they assessed it at $1 million, then they do send something to me and I do have the option to turn in something to the assessor's office to make that change there. There is also something by law that could change in regards to you know, there is a factor that it's not being overcharged, that it's something that the legislature has put in place to where the inflation changes. That's not something where we're being overcharged. But if someone disagrees with what they're being charged, you do have the option to contact the assessor's office to request that you be reassessed. So onto that, the next step in that process, but it does depend on the type of tax, would be then that the assessment then is sent to the auditor's office. The auditor's office would then take all the different factors then would come into play. So whether there's special assessments, if there are any bonds on that, and or whatever else would be applied to your particular tax rate area. So that tax rate would then be applied to your tax bill, and then from that point, then that is then sent to me, and then I would then issue that tax bill. And then from there, and then there's additional steps beyond that. We have typically my delinquency ratio has decreased over the years. So it's been, we've gone down, so we typically are about less than 10% delinquent ratio. But the question was, so it's the assessor, the auditor, the tax collector. But again, and there's different types of taxes.
Okay,
so.
Thank you, Terry. A lot of information there. Okay, treasurer, tax collector. Would you please describe any governmental investment and banking experiences you may have? Diane, let's go with Terry.
Governmental and investment banking experience that I have? I have banking and investment experience for over 20-plus years. I've worked for larger firms in banking, both in the public and private sector. Both of those are vastly different. Everything that we do is governed by government codes, penal codes, you name it, there's quite a bit of codes. As far as investment goes, on average, I manage a portfolio of over, $45 million. That includes the county roads, schools, special districts. That investment changes quarterly. So I have quite a bit of experience just in this particular position. So I've got over 10 years experience just in governmental investing.
Okay, thank you, Terry. Diane, same question. Please describe any governmental investment and banking experience you may have.
Again, I don't have governmental experience. Haven't worked for the government. But my grandfather, who I worked for, was a self-made millionaire in the stock market. And I worked as a protege to this investment banker. He actually worked for the government as well, retired military and what have you. And I was privy to that sort of information. One of the things I've looked at our investments, for instance, we have the percentage, and it's by law, in mutual funds, not considered a great one. We have two, and they remain like this for decades, Franklin Mutual, and then $2 million in this company, NASICS, which is French. It's associated with the Rothschilds, and it's been there. $2 million of our money has been with them, just riding. It's like, you're going to the casino and you just let it ride. That's not utilizing it. We can actually change that. We can change the way we invest. The majority of the money is in LAIF, which is local agency investment fund, and we're not really receiving what maybe we could. Meanwhile, though, we're like at 1% or 0.5% return, which shouldn't shock you if you have a savings account. However, the CalPERS says that their investments are getting 7.5%, and every time I've told the board that is a fantasy. There's no way. How could they be getting 7.5% when everybody else is getting, much less unless you have risky investments? So now what's happened is and I've been saying it for years to the board, we have to protect CalPERS to protect our employees and our pensioners. And it's been on deaf ears in my opinion. But now the state says, well, you know what, we are reducing it to now 7%. And it's going to go down more and more. And they're saying by 2025, which is right around the corner, we're going to be paying twice as much as what we're paying now into the CalPERS system to keep it afloat. It's really on a rocky ship right now. And we have to think about our pensioners because, for instance, Trinity County Water District, Brilliant Hayport, they just went basically belly up. They're getting like 30% of what their pension was, which is very, I'm sure, horrific for them that you counted on that. So this could happen, and it's happened to other cities, Stockton, other places where, and then what happens when that happens is you lose all your general funds for the deputies. For instance, when it happened, I think it was Vacaville, there wasn't a deputy on the streets when that collapsed. Now they have recovered, but you have to be very prudent, you have to be very conservative, and that's what I think in this position, I can really work with the supervisors and the department heads to show them that we need to be even more conservative in order to protect our pensioners and the ones that we have on board right now. It could implode on us, and we need to really look at this elephant in the room. Thank you.
Thank you. Moving up to the end of tax collector, one question is, what is Prop 13? And I thank you for the question, but I think that would take a little longer to move through from 68, whenever that was put in. Can you tell me how Prop 13 does affect my tax bill?
Prop 13 basically set the basis that you bought your house. However, they allow them to assess you, I think, 1.5% more each year. And we've seen that. So before you know it, you're up a lot. But it is a wonderful thing. In my opinion, I've spent a lot of time with the Howard Jarvis Association, by the way. I know them well. They're the ones that got that into place with us, and they defend it all the time. If we didn't have that, I'll give an example. My father, he owned a property that he bought for $45,000. By the time he was forced to sell it, he was a school teacher, it was in another state, it was assessed at $500,000. He said, I can't keep working just to pay my taxes. So he had to sell his home and get an RV because of that. So I really think it's a good, we're lucky to have it in this state. But it does increase all the time. By increments of 1.5%. They don't have to take the full 1.5%, but they do here.
How does Prop 13 affect my tax bill?
I would like to say also, we have not always taken that full percentage. That is not a true statement in regards to Prop 13. So my in-laws have owned their home for almost 20 years, so their taxes are significantly lower than what I would pay. So it's not a true comparison. If I want to compare my neighbors who've owned their home for 20, 30 years versus my home if I've owned it for 10 years. So your property taxes are going to be vastly different compared to your neighbor if you have not owned it for that same amount of time. So we're comparing apples and oranges. They are not the same thing. It's not the same comparison. And to say one is being overcharged, it is not a true statement. It is not a fact. And we have not consistently increased it by that factor every year. That is not a true statement.
Thank you very much. I have one more question. I'm not necessarily comfortable reading this, but I have no problem. It is for Diane Richard, and I probably would have just ignored it except for some of the statements you've made. We've seen videos of you clearly bullying a facilitator at a county collaborative meeting, as well as publicly abusing all of the supervisors at a BOS meeting, saying that they are all committing felonies and that John Fenley, yours truly, will be taken away in handcuffs without any proof of wrongdoing. You've harassed clerk recorder's office, the auditor's office, the DA's office, sheriff's office, and county administrative office. The building department, roads department, and our county courts department, our judges, and that pretty much covers it. You've clearly demonstrated that you are bullying and have no self-control in public. How can we trust that you won't treat the public in the same horrible way? Before you answer, so you can think about it, I'm kind of disappointed in the question. I wouldn't have brought it forward except some of the items that Diane has said that she does participate in and takes great pride in. So you got the question, Diane. You don't have to answer it if you don't want.
Oh, I would love to answer the question. All right, so I was taught that whenever I get any information, I do it through a California Open Records request, which I write a letter and I say, I would like this documentation, please provide it. On the payments all of us are making, over $60,000 towards John Finley's legal fees in the election contest. That lawsuit is a private person against a private person. It is a violating of penal code, misappropriation of public funds, 424. It's a felony. to use any public funds to pay for any candidate, any candidate's interest, anything of that nature, including initiatives and referendums. So we have that information. We're in the courts right now in it, trying to get an injunction to stop those payments. We have notified them. We've had people get up, not just me, in front of the supervisor saying, this is illegal what you're doing. You need to stop it. And they're not. They did it. They originated in a closed session where there was no public notice that they're even going to discuss doing that to provide that kind of funding for him. So that was also a violation of the Brown Act and maybe even something much worse. So these things we're looking into. On the Sheriff's Department, I don't know what I've ever done to the Sheriff's Department. Eric Hereford is working with me on this. He actually referred this complaint to the Attorney General. I would definitely say that I have issues with the elections office, the clerk, recorder, assessor, who is actually violating the law. In 2016, 40 different laws were violated during that election. On the Board of Supervisors, I'll give an example. The Board of Supervisors Chair, Deborah Chapman, who removed me after I was only speaking 1 minute into my 3 minutes on public session that I was talking about writs of assistance, which is a revolutionary war history about one of the reasons why the war started. They wanted to change warrants, that they could come with administrative warrants onto your property here in Trinity County, and I wanted to give the history. She stopped me. She had me taken out by a deputy. I think I should be treated kindly. And I didn't do anything to her. I can actually just go sue her on the board for that because that is violating my free speech. But one of the things, for instance, when I was doing the audit, I found that Deborah Chapman she's the board chair. They elect the board, put her on the first five committee, and I found this in my audit with Marilyn Horn. And she got, as the director of First Five, $5,000 a month. And that's the First Five money is when you buy cigarettes, you pay a tax, and it goes into that program. I don't do anything like that. I think we need to have a very transparent system there. For instance, like a cash report, to know how much money is in every single fund and account that this county has. They would not let me see the banks. We spend between $30,000 and $100,000 a month on credit cards, which is just ludicrous, okay? So why would they let me have this? I wanted to know what those expenditures were for. And I think the public should be able to have that. And they said I was overly burdensome and would not let me have that information. I am a citizen. They're supposed to be completely transparent. You have to go through the county council, and they stop you from getting the information. Thank you.
Thank you, Diane. I'm going to tie that up for the treasurer tax collector. I'm going to ask you to come up with your closing statements. And do you have a preference you would like to start? How about Diane, you just finished. Let's go for Terry.
Okay, so I'd like to start off with just a, there are many other responsibilities that I have just on treasurer and tax collector that I'd like to make people aware of a lot of others, and it's just those two things. There are many above and beyond that. Not only are we responsible with deadlines, notices, and things of that sort, but we also have publications, auctions, processing escapes, payroll distribution, interest apportionment, processing requests for parcel maps, lot line adjustments, tax clearance certificates, bulk tax transfers. We perform daily, monthly, and quarterly reconciliation between the auditor's office, between our cash, our banking, investments, and funds. I would like to also speak to some incorrect statements that were stated, so that's what I would like to, how I'd like to finish that up. I would like to make it very clear that CalPERS is in no way, shape, or form in our county pool. So that is not something that treasurer, tax collector, whether that be myself or someone else, that is not under our control. So we cannot dictate that. When you're speaking to investing in investments versus a regular investments that I would invest in regular county pools, I am very restricted All of our investments must be 5 years and under. When you are pertaining to a retirement fund, which I've also done in the past, but that is not allowable under government code for my Treasury County pool. This is for our taxpayer dollars. That's not allowable. So we're talking apples and oranges again. So CalPERS, it's not in our pool, nor is that what CalPERS invests in. That is not allowable for us. So we are talking, again, interest rates and things like that. It's not comparable. It's not allowable. And as far as transparent, in regards to Natixis and LAIF, Natixis, and we have actually two particular types of mutual funds that those are something that were purchased in the 90s, but something that I inherited. It is something that feel free to anyone who's interested, you can contact me or look online. But that is something that I'm gradually selling off. But there's in the investment world, there's ways that you have to do that for that particular type of fund. But that is something that I am gradually selling off. I inherited it. But my primary interest is to have the least amount of a negative impact for the county pool participants. That's you. That's the schools. That's everyone involved. So I am selling that off, and I am taking care of those. But that is something that I inherited. Again, that's and in regards to LAIF, we are coming into over my time in office, we're talking about a near zero interest rate environment. We didn't have some of the impacts that some of the other counties did. I didn't have to sell short. You didn't take a negative. We didn't have a negative, of course. We didn't have a negative impact. So we didn't have those things. And credit card statements, those are transparent. Those are we are required by that, and there's more than one audit that takes place in regards to that. Those are transparent. But I would appreciate your vote. You have my dog, and please talk to me.
Alright, some of the things that I want to institute, which actually Terry has already started, is to open the office from 8 to 5. She has just begun to keep the office now from just only several hours a day to 9 to 4. So great, I'm not in, and it's already improving. I brought up that the quarterly investment reports were not posted. She now has them all updated and posted. Thank you very much. One of the other things that I want to do is have an oversight committee. That would be made up between 10 and 12 citizens that hopefully would have like some CPA background, what have you, to oversee what I do, to make sure with complete transparency, this is one of the things that should be in place, and it's not, and there's no reason why it shouldn't be. The hiring practices in the office, I have a chart here that says there's only two people working in that office, maybe she'd like to update that, but what I've heard is that there is somebody working in that office, allegedly from a very good source, that was accused of embezzlement at three different financial institutions. And we need to look into that. I've had many people have said to me that they have paid their tax bill there, and then they get billed for the same thing that they did, they had already paid. And it's been brought up to me many times. This is one of the red flags that's been brought up to me. So there's a lot of things that we need to do. And I'm not saying that, for instance, Terry, if I were elected, I think Terry, she was an employee before, she could be a great employee again. But I think that we need to look closely at the employees there to make sure that they are completely, maybe a polygraph examination, et cetera, so that we know where our money's going. I want every dime to be accounted for in that office, and I want to post every month what our balances are in every single account. I mean, full transparency. And hopefully we'll have 10 to 12 citizens that will come in on the oversight committee and make sure that we're doing everything perfectly. And again, I hope that you'll give me that chance to do this. And I even look forward to working with Terry and the auditor. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Diane. I'd like to have a little round of applause for I'm going to move on to our really pensive video. I'm talking about the sheriff. Sheriff is going to go last, and I'm doing that on purpose because I'd like you three to have participation afterwards if the people would like to hang around and talk to them all. So I'm going to move on to our clerk assessor. going to start out with your opening statements and 2 minutes. And I've added another minute to your closing statement because after you hear everything that's going around, you might have some responses. So those are going for 3 minutes now. Diane, you were way ahead of schedule.
Oh.
Thank you very much.
I have it back.
Let's start with Forenza. You ready for your opening?
Absolutely.
Thank you very much.
So, as everybody knows here, I'm Forenza Pini, and I spent 12 years fighting for our rights and freedoms. Our right to liberty and the pursuit of happiness is constantly being threatened by officials who believe that the people are not capable of governing their own lives. This needs to change and needs to start with our elections. Making sure that our elections are honest is the first step to ensuring our liberty. The second step is to involve the public in every aspect of the electoral process. From voting to observing elections to running for office, the people must participate, and as our elections officer, it will be my mission to make sure these activities are easy to do and that more people participate in running our county and our country. Our assessments are too high and are in fact abnormal, with a backlog of appeals caused by misassessments. Our poor citizens are suffering because of this incorrect application of tax laws and are unable to find relief from the current assessor's office. Please join me in giving Trinity County back its prosperity by voting for me so that we can live our lives, knowing that there are people who will fight for us and that we can fight for ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you, Florenza.
Next.
Yes, ma'am.
I have to stand. Right? So, I don't know, I'm a little parched today. The altitude maybe. So I'm really here to offer you a choice. You haven't had much of a choice over almost the last decade. We've had a series of appointed people that are in this role outside of a few months. So I really want to offer you that choice, and I'd ask you to please make the right choice with Lisa Wright. Why, you ask, why might I be well suited for this position? Well, I have about 30 years in the workforce, and I've come out of kind of a semi-retired state here in beautiful Trinity County to start taking a look at the government around me, because I had been really involved in government before. So I have a high school diploma. I also have a bachelor's degree in political science and French. I went on to a master's degree in public administration, where I was specifically trained in the management of government offices. Following my graduate's degree, I was selected as one of 200 in the presidential management program. This was during the Bush administration Reagan into Bush, so I kind of date myself there a little bit. But we were selected to really come in and help improve the efficiency and effectiveness of government. It's a really exciting time. I lived in Washington, D.C., among all the politicians, and really at the heart of politics. And in that role, I worked for the U.S. Department of Justice. I was at the Executive Office for the U.S. Trustees. And there I helped roll out a pilot program that was designed to be self-funded. So maybe I'm running for the wrong office. I don't know. I have a lot of investment background. But no, really that has given me some really good insight into how government offices should work, how to start from the very beginning, and take it out to, to full implementation. In that role, I also decided I'd really like to try to do some field work. So I started working with the FBI, went to the Federal Law Enforcement Training Center, and trained in white-collar crime and fraud investigation. And I think that's a really important aspect of my background to kind of help me look critically at operations in not only business but government. That was about the first part of my background. After that, I decided, I really want to go back to my roots, to my home. The fraud investigator position was supposed to roll out to the field, and then Bush came in, and you know how they do the political appointments and they change ideas and things. Am I running out of time? Okay. So,
if you'd like to wind it up, I'd appreciate it.
Okay. The other ones have been 3 months. So really my goals in this role here is to bring you fair and free elections. It's paramount to our individual liberty and freedom. I believe very strongly in our Constitution and the Bill of Rights. And your rights need to be protected. And I feel like an elected official has those interests in mind rather than appointed officials that have been kind of perpetuated. So my goal is really to protect your rights, have efficient and effective government, and I ask for your vote on June 5th. Make the right choice. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Shanna White. I'm your current County Clerk, Recorder, Assessor. I'd like to thank you all for coming out tonight to get to know your candidates before casting your vote. I'd like to thank the Six River Seniors for hosting this event. A little bit about me. My family moved to Trinity County in 1985. My husband and I have been married for 30 years. We have a successful business, light construction and roofing, and we're the proud parents of two daughters who were born and raised in Trinity County. In 2015, I was appointed the County Clerk Recorder Assessor. In 2010, I accepted the position of the Deputy County Clerk Recorder Assessor. So I've been in the office for 8 years. I have 8 years experience. Whether appointed or elected, you still take the job very seriously. My career for Trinity County began in 1995. I worked in the Auditor's Office for 15 years prior to going to the Clerk Recorder Assessor's Office. And in 2011, I received my property tax appraiser certificate, which is a requirement to appraise properties in the state of California. I currently hold certificates in Recordable Document Examiner. I've been taking, I'm four courses away from my advanced certified tax appraiser certificate. I've taken courses in California Professional Elections Administration Credential. I continue to attend conferences and meetings to stay up to date on laws and policies. Since my appointment, I've done everything possible to keep the confidentiality of voters confidential, their personal information. I run elections honestly and to election code. I've increased the office hours since my time becoming the Clerk Recorder Assessor, the ability to examine documents online, and to, with the assistance of the tax collector, the treasurer tax collector, to collect fees with credit cards. I've dedicated the past 23 years to Trinity County, and most importantly, the past 8 in the Clerk Recorder Assessor's Office. And I run, my departments run effectively and with integrity. So I look forward to continue serving you and appreciate your vote on June 5th. Thank you.
Seem to overlap a little bit with the treasurer tax collector, so we're looking forward to that. Let's start with the front of it. What makes you decide to reassess my property?
Well, most of the time, your property is reassessed if it's being sold. That's the most common time when a property is reassessed, as far as I know. But if you request that your property be reassessed, that's definitely a time that you reassess the property. And because of Prop 13, unless you build something additional onto your property, most of the time you don't reassess properties because you own it and it stays fairly stable. So.
Thank you. That's right. The question is, what makes you decide to reassess my property?
Well, I think Forenza covered it pretty well. It would most likely be in the event of improvements to your property. As she indicated, we're kind of just repeating the same thing. But you're protected somewhat with the increased valuation by Prop 213. So I wouldn't myself probably go out and request a reassessment. But when you take out a building permit or make improvements to your home, that's something that would trigger a sale of your home, a purchase of a new home. That's something that triggers an assessment as well, as I understand it.
Thank you, Candidate White. What makes you decide to reassess my property 3 times now?
A reassessable transaction could be anything from a sale, a construction in progress, or a Prop 8 request, or a calamity. So a calamity would be if a fire or something came through, your property would be reassessed. A Prop 8 transaction, that would be you come in because you bought your property in the height of the market back in 2006, and so you pay top dollar for it, and now it's not, market price is not going for that. You can request a Prop 8. Therefore, it'd be reassessed. If you're building something on your property, you've got a permit, you've made some construction in progress, so if on January 1, anything you've done up to that date will be reassessed, and then it'll be reassessed again once it's done. Or a transfer of property, you sold the property, you before you purchased a property.
Okay, Ms. Wright, how do you decide to accept or reject a document to be recorded?
Well, I've never recorded documents, and so I would be looking to my staff to do that. I really feel the role of the office is to manage and not necessarily do all of the tasks. If you set it up that that person has control over all of the tasks, you're opening it up for the opportunity for wrongdoing. So I feel that there's a need for checks and balances. The position should really manage the office and make sure that you have good staff in place. So certificates, those kind of things are all good for staff, and I would be looking at that when I'm examining the people that would stay with the office, but that wouldn't be my particular direct role.
So to accept or reject a document, there's laws out on what is required to record a document. We have a manual that is put out by the Clerk Recorder Assessors Association that gives you the guidelines. You need to have a grantor or grantee. You need to have, specifically a grantee, grantor or grantee, a legal description, the signature notarized. And in the Trinity County, we're all small offices. So yeah, I would love to say I'm the department head who doesn't have boots on the ground working in the office. There is somebody in the office who does. If you came in on a daily basis, you would deal with someone else other than me. But if she's not there, somebody has to help you. So therefore, I do know how to record a document. And department heads have to work in Trinity County.
Absolutely. How do you decide to accept or reject a document to be recorded?
Oh, well, that's a little different than I would say the answers that we've gotten so far, because you're saying that we can reject documents. And I'm sure that there are certain laws that allow you to reject a document, but unless your paper you're trying to file is violating one of those statutes or one of those codes, then you file it.
Okay, this one's for, we'll start down with the candidate. Wait, what is Prop 13? Please don't. I'll ask you not to cover Prop 13. How does it affect me and my tax bill? I understand how it affects me, and I'm sure we all do. Let's move right to how does it affect my tax bill.
So Prop 13 was something passed by the voters in 75. What it gives you a base year value. So what the assessment was on your property when you had that reassessable transaction, that's your value, and it can only be raised based on the Consumer Price Index, which is issued by the Board of Equalization annually. It can be raised only by that amount, no more than 2% a year.
Thank you.
Brenda? Okay. That's exactly what Shanna said. I have nothing more to add.
Shanna was right.
You know, the law is the law.
I think
she interpreted it well, so hopefully we get some more kind of subjective questions.
Okay, well, I don't know. These look like they're all loaded. I don't know. Does anybody have any questions that they just thought of? No? Okay, write them down, bring them up if you want to. These are all pretty much what triggers a property tax assessment? Forenza? Moving on, we'll start with Forenza again. You become aware that a clerk is not entering all the registered and into the system. What do you do?
You mean, does that question mean that one of my staff is not entering in the people who are registering to vote?
You become aware that a clerk is not entering all the registered into the system. Exclamation point. What do you do? Question.
Oh, well, first of all, enter in those people that weren't entered in. First thing. And then you... Well... You would, I'm sorry, I forgot the word, but you, I would say you interview your staff to see who mistakenly did not enter in. Did they purposely not enter in? If they did it on purpose, well, I would say that somebody probably needs to be fired. But if it's an accident, it's an accident, and you correct the problem, and you keep a closer watch in the future so that it doesn't happen anymore.
Thank you. Candidate White, you need the question. It's not that I'm moving further away, it's just I don't understand the registrar. Probably something.
I think what it's in the registration forms, as Forensic had said. So I think first and foremost, you would find out why your staff isn't doing something. And as a department head, you would manage that staff appropriately and find out why they're not doing it. Is there an issue with not knowing how to do it? Is it an issue of prioritizing their work and just get it done?
With a simple question. Okay. I agree with, you know, what's been said here. It's a very administrative function, so you want to check and make sure that your people are properly trained. There should be checks and balances in place so that if someone has responsibility for something as important as registering a voter, that there's another correction, a step where that's checked. All the registrations are supposed to be preserved, so you can always go back and double check. And there should be that kind of a series of checks and balances.
I have a real quick question. It's clerk assessor report, clerk recorder assessor. So there's three items. I thought there were five. Forensic?
Well, all of the other items all
I'm
go
actually
under...
just asking what the items are that
oh, well, there's clerk recorder assessor, there's the registrar of voters, and that includes the elections officer.
Okay.
I agree with that one.
The clerk recorder assessor, the clerk issues certified copies of vital records. They issue marriage licenses. The registrar of voters falls under the clerk because county does not have a registrar of voters. The recorder's office records any document that needs to be recorded due to real property documents. And the assessor's office assesses values on anything assessable. Personal or real property in the county.
Okay, I just wanted that clarification because there's actually five items that they have to deal with instead of just three. I've run out of questions and I'm moving right along at a good clip here. These three candidates got a great round of applause. No stand. What can I say? Yeah, they get a follow-up and also a closing statement. Again, I'm giving you 3 minutes. We're going to start with Ms. Wright. Again, 3 minutes. Let's stick to this one.
Could you give me like a 30-second?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, in closing, I just want to go back to, you know, my roots. As a little girl, I loved to go to the library and read everything I could about the presidency. I had went back to, you know, Abraham Lincoln and Andrew Jackson, everyone, right? And I was really enthralled by the idea of government and our liberties. And so that's really what's led me to run for this office, is that I want to be your elected official who can ensure that your rights are being protected. I think my qualifications far exceed, with my background and experience, the minimum qualifications for this office. I'm happy to share any other details with you if you'd like to discuss my background. And what I'm really doing is I'm really doing this for you, as I said, to give you a choice. And we have three candidates, so that's great. I hate to see one candidate and you don't really end up with a choice. I also hate to see a perpetuation of board-appointed officials where you don't have a say, really, in who those are. We do have problems that have been identified in this area. There was a grand jury report that came out last year around the election office. Grand jury reports are signed by the judge. They're considered factual documents. If you don't, you haven't had a chance to review that. There are some things that specifically affected this district as well as public participation and observation. I'd also like to make sure that we look at the capabilities to open up some of the polling places that have been closed down. And some of that's really determined by budget. There's nothing in the law that says there's a certain number of people you need to have to open a polling place. And that would be, of course, go to the Board of Supervisors who ultimately decides on the budget for this office. But I think that's very important that you have that option, that you're not forced to just do something to vote by mail. There's also, and this was touched on by one of the treasurer candidates, the Board of Equalization actually came out with a report in 2014 during the tenure of our current clerk recorder assessor, citing 22 significant problems in the assessment area. Those are supposed to be reported on annually as to how those are being corrected, and I haven't been able to find those reports, so I'm hoping that possibly some light could be shed and that could be posted on the website so that people have that information about how we're continuing to try to improve our operations. So, once again, I'm here to give you a choice and an option, and I would ask you to make the right choice, Lisa Wright, on June 5th, asking for your vote. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Lisa, you've got 39 seconds.
Rub it in.
You don't have a good show.
I'm going to move on to candidate White. 3 minutes.
Hi, once again, I'd like to thank Six River Seniors and John for hosting this and all of you for coming out tonight to get to know your candidates. There's been quite a few things that have been said about me personally and how I handle my office and the laws that they say I do not follow. That is completely false. There was a grand jury report. Lisa is correct. There was a grand jury report that came out last year, and there was members of that grand jury who had their own personal vendetta against my office. The same people who are filing lawsuits that are costing the county thousands and thousands of dollars. My office in itself, $40,000 just this year. As for opening polling places were closed 15 years ago out here in these areas. And I'm sorry that you don't have a polling place here, but there is not the turnout at polls. Even in where there are polling places, their turnout for people who are voting at polls is 10 to 15%, as where it's 40 and 50% vote by mail. So the trend is more people are wanting to vote by mail. Do it in the comfort of your home. It has nothing to do with budget, because the poll workers who are working the polls get paid a mere $75 an hour. They're not doing it for the money, it's for their civic duty. So it's not budget. Once again, I just want you to know there's been false allegations. If you have any questions, please come ask me before listening to hearsay. And I'm an open book. If you need to know something, I'm going to tell you. I don't beat around the bush. I'm not a very good politician. I hate to say it. And I look forward to continue serving you, and look forward to your vote on June 5th. Thank you.
And you did mean $75 a day,
me.
Not an hour.
Hey. No. No. You're of rubbish. All people.
And you're <rubbish. laughs>
Thank you, Shanna, and thank you for inciting. My boss. Forenza? Thank you. Thank you for being patient sitting through that.
So, I will make a great elections officer because I love the electoral process. I want voter registration to be at an all-time high during my tenure. People need to participate in the electoral process because elections are the foundation of our republic, and without them, there will be no liberty. Some of my goals are the registration of all high school students that are old enough to vote, and I hope to have an additional class so that they can learn about the electoral process and their rights as voters. I want to reopen our polling places, like right here, because closing nearly all the polling places has added to the disenfranchisement of voters. I intend to follow the law which mandates that every voter receive a voter card that shows their name, address, and party affiliation, so each voter can be sure all is correct. One of my goals is to train the personnel, both permanent and temporary, like poll workers and canvas workers, so they are professional and follow the law. I plan to restructure each department so that it will run smoothly and competently, with the goal being to provide excellent service. I have been working diligently to fix our elections office, and I have found the only way I can do this is from the inside as the elections officer. So please join me. Help me make our county freer and more open on June 5th.
Thank you very much, Kennedy. You are done. On to our sheriffs now. You want a break?
No.
Okay. Moving on to our sheriffs. I want to make sure that I switch, start with Mark, then move down the line and switch it out a little bit. So if you think I'm not switching it out right, just let me know.
You did pretty good on ours.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. No comments. We're going to keep it down. But thanks for the vote of confidence. Let's start with Mr. Potts, if you don't mind. Candidate Potts, Deputy Sheriff Potts. Thank you. Thank you for coming tonight also. Why do you want to be sheriff? Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
Opening statement.
Yeah, they are. They're going to have their opening statement. You get 2 minutes. This questions card is new, and there's actually some really good questions on it. I'm really anxious to get to it. Give a stand, introduce, and let's give you your 2 minutes for your opening statement. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Mark Bond, running for sheriff. Even though professional chronology, graduated high school, joined the Marine Corps in 1975. Spent 4 years in the Marine Corps, changed branch of the service, and joined the Air Force, where I spent 4 years as well in the Air Force. And at that time, my PTS Air Force went back to the Marine Corps for an additional 3 years before entering the Army. And I spent another number of years in the Army before retiring from the Army in 1998. My first time shortly thereafter, I got on in my second career as a deputy sheriff here at the Trinity County Sheriff's Office, and then been in that capacity now for nearly 20 years. I've served in the patrol division, narcotics division, jail division, and I'm currently serving as a patrol deputy. And like I say, I've been in the department for a long time, and things are kind of not as good as when I got there, and I've seen over the years things that have been tried, things that have worked, things that have not worked, things that could be done, that are not being done, and basically that's why I'm here. The next question is why I'm running for sheriff is to...
Let's hold off enough so you have full time to...
I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Candidate Potts. Who would like to go next, Deputy Sheriff Hanover?
Hi, I'm Corporal Hanover, and I work with the Trinity County Sheriff's Office. I was born in Trinity County 59 years ago. I'm fourth generation Trinity County native. My wife, Audrey, was also raised here. Our children were born and raised here. I worked in our sawmills, forest, and private businesses. I love this county and have a lot invested in Trinity County. I've been serving Trinity County as a deputy with the Sheriff's Office for 20 years. I started my career at the Sheriff's Department working in the jail and quickly promoted to a patrol deputy. I was the lead deputy for many years and was promoted to corporal in charge of administering the code enforcement program for the past 5 years. Some of my training, I've got 8 years in the United States Coast Guard, worked for the Sheriff's Office for 21 years. I was on patrol for 15 years, 14 of those years as a field training officer. I'm trained special weapons and tactic. I'm a SWAT sniper currently. Other trainings, drug and danger, children investigation, active shooter emergency response train, supervisory management training, post investigator train. I've got my basic, intermediate, and advanced certificates. My plan points, build lasting partnerships with our citizenry, work with community organizations to proactively address growing concerns, address employee retention and recruitment, obtain funding for additional deputies, address the rising concerns for school safety, improve response time to calls for service, hold deputies accountable to community concerns, protect our watersheds from harmful pesticides, establish an environment of community involvement, address homelessness and related issues, help build the Sheriff's Auxiliary to be an extension of the Sheriff's Office.
Thank you. Candidate? Yes. 2 minutes. When you introduce yourself, is there a title? If you could use that.
Is there a title?
Title. I don't know. Are you still working for the Marshals?
I'm currently working for the Marshals Office at Trinity Superior Court. So I'm the Deputy Marshal.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you all for being here tonight. My name is Tim Saxon. I'm running for sheriff. I want to be your sheriff. We moved to Trinity County in 1998. when I was selected to become the CHP commander of the Trinity River office here. My family came up here with me, two kids. They went to the elementary school, graduated Trinity High School, went off to universities, graduated from UC Davis, and graduated from San Diego State. And they both moved back to Trinity County. They enjoyed their childhood here growing up so much, they wanted to be a part of it again. My wife has been a business owner in Trinity County since 2006. Both of my kids, the oldest one is a probation officer. My younger one works for Trinity Superior Court as the judicial secretary and the jury commissioner. My career started in law enforcement, got over 30 years in. I started in 1983, graduated CHP Academy in Sacramento. I was sent to the lovely La La Land, where I performed field patrol down in Los Angeles and Baldwin Park. I was a field sergeant in those areas as well. I also worked various division assignments and headquarters assignments as a sergeant before promoting to lieutenant. Went out to the Bay Area, worked the field in San Jose and Oakland as the administrative lieutenant in those commands, managing up to 90 employees at a time. Went back to headquarters where I worked in the Office of Special Projects, and I did the department's grants program, about $45 million in grants. I managed that with my staff. I ran the California Motorcycle Safety Program. I also taught at the CHP Academy, and I taught at various other locations around the state, including Office of Traffic Safety seminars. Came up to Trinity River in 1998. Spent 10 years at McMahon here before going to Redding, where I was the field administrative officer for all of Northern California, performing such duties as auditing, grants management, budgeting, did inventory control, investigations of employees, citizens' complaints, and things like that. Had a lot of training opportunities throughout my 30-plus years. Okay, let me wind it up with saying that I want to be your sheriff, and I'm going to answer that question next.
Thank you.
You know what? I gave them all the first question. Canada Potts, why do you want to be sheriff?
Like I said, I've been there a long time, and I've seen a steady, persistent decline in manpower and the morale that goes with that. And we need to try something different. Every election cycle, I've been through several administrations and even more election cycles. And every administration, every cycle seems to get the same answer. We keep trying to approach the budgeting issues the same way. And I think that we need, at this point, we need to look at doing something different. And that's what I plan on doing, is doing something different. Because what are we doing? What we've been doing for the past 20 years is obviously not working. So we've got to do something different.
Thank you. Canada Hanover, why do you want to be sheriff?
Well, there's lots of reasons.
Okay, well, I'm not going to give you a whole lot of time. Please.
Well, I think, you know, I being from this county and working in the sheriff's office for the past 21 years, you know, I've really invested in this county, and I feel that with what I've learned over the last 21 years, that I can make a change by becoming the new sheriff. And Mark is right. Things have been the same we've been there about the same amount of time, and not much has changed, and we have the same ideas about things have got to change in our office. I want the opportunity to work with our communities, work with our people in our office, and make those changes happen.
Thank you. Kenneth Saxon, why do you want to be here?
As I said, we moved here 20 years ago. My kids were small at the time, and this was a perfect environment for them to be raised, and I loved it. I could let them go outside and not even have to worry about them until it was dark and time to come home. And I don't know about you, but over the last 20 years, things have changed, and I would not let them do that now. And since they both came back to Trinity County, my wife and I, we're vested in here. We're coming up on 31 years of marriage now. And, you know, we're not going to be leaving the area. We're going to be staying here. And I want to do everything I can, utilizing my 30-plus years of law enforcement experience, to bring new ideas, because the two gentlemen here are correct. The same thing is not going to work anymore. You need new ideas. I have fresh ideas that I've gained from my time as an officer, a sergeant, lieutenant, and a captain. Various parts of the state working with local, state, and federal entities. And I believe I have the experience, the knowledge, and the desire to cultivate new coalitions, not just from not just money from one source, but finding money from all different sources to come in and solve the problems that we have.
Thank you very much. Candidate Hanover, will you, this is for all three of you, will you enforce federal laws?
Yes.
Thank you. Candidate Saxon.
Which federal laws in general? In general, yes. I believe in building coalitions with our federal and state partners when you're dealing with some items such as illegal forest grows. Those issues are much beyond the capacity of the Trinity County Sheriff's Department, and we need as much assistance as we can to solve that issue. If you're talking immigration federal policies, that's something totally different. I believe what Orange County Sheriff has just done with regard to Senate Bill 54, and that being publicizing the time and date of release of all people in the jail system. The main issue was that the state's governor said that we cannot work with ICE when illegal immigrants are being released from jail unless there's a warrant on file. I love what the sheriff did down there, not taking any sides, just saying everybody's going to be publicized, thereby giving the opportunity for the federal agents that want to come in and take control. The people that we don't want here, they're criminals. We want them to be taken care of.
Thank you. Senator Potts?
No, I will not enforce federal law. I mean, they will be more than you. I have no authority to enforce federal law. We only enforce state and county.
Thank you, sir. Start with Candidate Saxon. What do you think is the most important skill of the sheriff?
The sheriff is a lead law enforcement agency, or the lead law enforcement person in the county. There's 58 of them in California, so they're pretty rare. Kind of like when I was a captain with the Highway Patrol, there were 247 captains out of 11,000 employees. So it's pretty rare, and it takes somebody with a lot of skills, a lot of management, administrative, and field skills to be able to take on the role. The sheriff as a leader has to be able to talk to various groups, has to be able to interface with legislators at the state and the federal level if necessary. Has to be able to build bridges and coalitions with Board of Supervisors and other department heads and county organizations in order to accomplish the mission, and that mission is protection of the public. The leader, as a sheriff, also has to be able to ensure that within the department itself, people are being taken care of, being treated fairly, without discrimination, given opportunities to learn new tasks and new jobs to better themselves. And also, the sheriff is responsible for building a succession plan so that when he or she steps down, somebody else is ready to come in and has the knowledge and ability and the skills to take over in the next election.
Thank you. I lost my place. Who's going first on the next
one?
Or did I get the answer?
Or.
This is a test. You got to pay attention. Your friends and knows exactly where I am.
Would you like me to tell you?
Yeah, absolutely, ma'am.
Mark is next.
Okay. Got kind of a loaded question here. Can you guarantee us that we will be able to keep our resident deputy? First of all, I will admit that as far as I'm concerned, we do not have a resident deputy now.
Yeah.
But I'm sure we would like one. So in at least Mad River, Eden, Kenton Palm, wherever we can grab some.
The answer is no, I cannot guarantee that anybody will have a resident deputy.
Okay, would you like to see one down here?
I would like to see all of the outlying areas have resident deputies, absolutely.
Okay.
They deserve that. Unfortunately, they're not getting it.
Perfect, thank you. Deputy Sheriff Hanover.
Oh, you're right. There's no guarantees, but, you know, I intend on, you know, as long as it's possible to keep one here, I have no intention of removing the resident deputy we have here now. As far as until something else changes.
Part of my question, but okay.
What was that?
I don't think we have a resident deputy here. Whoever wrote this up there incorrect. We just have a deputy sheriff. But you answered the question. It's very similar. And I agree. Candidate Saxon.
Read that question again, please.
The question is actually, can you guarantee us, meaning South of the South Fork, that we will be able to keep our resident deputy? And my addition to that is that I don't think we have a resident deputy. Yes, we have a deputy that is a resident deputy, but most of the time he is on patrol elsewhere.
As is stated, there is no guarantee. We cannot guarantee that. I cannot guarantee that. But I can guarantee you that I will work hard to get additional personnel on the department, and the main priority is resident deputies. If we can get another resident deputy in Hayfork, that will keep your resident deputy here instead of having to respond to calls there or even up to Weaverville. And it's a staffing issue, and that needs to be addressed. It needs to be pulled out. And it's going to take money, and there are different ways of looking for the money. I have some different ideas than the other two gentlemen, but I think that I can make it happen. I'm confident that I won't give up until I do make something happen. But you, just like was mentioned, you deserve to have a resident deputy here. Burnt Ranch deserves to have one. Trinity Center deserves to have one.
Excuse me, what's Trinity Center?
Never mind. But, so I mean, that's the answer. I'll work hard to do that, but I can't guarantee it.
Deputy Sheriff Hanover, other than your law enforcement duties within our county, how and what else do you do within your communities to make them a better place?
I've been, lately, not a lot, other than trash cleanups in Hayfork and Weaverville. I've participated in some pretty extensive cleanup projects, and I've brush removal where there's been some homeless issues. I've had crews come in and clean up some of the brush issues. As far as organizations in the county, I'm currently involved with the Weaverville Rod and Gun Club. I think that's just about pretty much involved with right at the moment.
Okay, Kenneth Saxon, you want to hear it again?
Yes, please.
Okay, other than your law enforcement duties within our county, how and what else do you do within our your communities to make them a better place?
Ah, okay. We'll go back in time a little bit. I was at the elementary school for my kids. I volunteered there as a reader, so I'd go in and read to the classes. We also did the wagon trip, so I volunteered twice to do the wagon trip with the kids going up to the park and doing that. My wife and I both volunteered as chaperones for the basketball team and the cheerleaders, which I thought I was a cheerleader, but we volunteered to do that and take the kids to Crescent City, Mount Shasta. Been involved a lot with the Every 15 Minutes program, California Youth Council, Rotary Club in Weaverville. I was the president for 1 year. I went on to be assistant governor for our district for 3 years, and then lieutenant governor for a year. We participated in the Trek for Trash in Hayfork, as well as the Weaverville Support Service that goes out and cleans up the creek beds. I'm also a member of the Weaverville Rod and Gun Club. I've been a member for about 5 years now. And, there's more, but that's all I can remember right now.
Kind of thoughts?
Being a full-time working deputy and a full-time working bodybuilder. I have my time is limited, and the limited time that I do have in downtime, I spend a good portion of that reading so that I can make myself a better sheriff.
Thank you, sir. Deputy Sheriff Hanover, if elected, would you keep things in the department the way they are or change course?
Similar, but there's definitely got to be changes. And, you know, big changes are not good, I don't feel. But there's a need for change, but they'll be gradual. But no, they are not going to stay the same.
Okay, thank you. Candidate Saxon, if elected, would you keep things in the department the way they are or change course?
The thing I learned over my many years in law enforcement, every time I promoted, move to a different office, and you got a chance to look at different approaches to the same problems. My approach to this is I do not go into an office making changes. I go in there and observe. I go in there, I talk to every single employee. I find out if they know what their job is and how important they are to the whole system, and ensure that they know that our primary job is the delivery of law enforcement services to you, the public. I'm good at auditing, I'm good at budgeting, I'm very good at looking at administrative processes to make sure that every dollar is being spent properly, and can money that's being wasted in one area be put towards something else, such as training, because I feel training is extremely important for everyone within the department. So that's the whole thing. I do not go in and say, chop off the block, we're going to start over. I will sit there and I go on ride-alongs with people. I will go on, I'll spend the day with the resident deputy. You can show me all the good fishing spots. But anyway, that's how I approach it.
Thank you very much. Candidate Ponce, if elected, would you keep things in the department the way they are or change course?
I kind of agree with Tim to a degree there. You don't want to throw out the baby with the bathwater, so to speak. You're going to want to make minor modifications, that's the whole idea for running for sheriff. Things aren't going exactly as you think they should go. So if you're going to make minor modifications and redirect resources, but you're not going to blow the place up and make a bunch of changes. So they're going to be minor and out of time, right?
Okay.
And most of that's going to be based off of manpower.
Great, thank you. Going to start with you again on the next question. What distinguishes you from the other candidates?
I believe I have much greater knowledge of the Constitution, and that's basically the very purpose for the existence of government, and the sheriff himself is to protect the people's property rights, and I have a very intimate knowledge of the Constitution and the constitutional rule of law.
Thank you, Candidate Hanover. What distinguishes you from the other candidates?
I think the bottom line is my grassroots in this county and being connected with all the county and being a deputy sheriff for 21 years with all my training experience that I've gathered over the years. Mark's worked here as a deputy sheriff is about as long as I have. So that's really all I got is that, I have 21 years of deputy sheriff experience, lots of training. When I'm the sheriff, I will know exactly what my guys are doing, what they're investigating, how to investigate crimes, how to write search warrants. I know how to do all of them things. So.
Okay. Thank you. Candidate, what distinguishes you from the other candidates?
Well, when all three of us started our law enforcement career, we started off going to a post academy, peace officer standards and training. We all get the same basic training in California if you're a peace officer. So we all started on a level ground. I chose a different path. I chose to, after doing my patrol time, I promoted to sergeant, promoted to lieutenant, promoted to captain, because I felt that myself, I could give more to the agency by going up, promoting, and gaining additional knowledge on various types of activities. I've always been engaged in every one of the commands I went into. By engagement, I mean you know what your people are doing. Ron says it exactly right. You've got to know what your people are doing. You have to know that they're heading down the same path, because as the leader, you're making up your strategic plan. You're making up, this is the direction that we're going to go, because the people need to have that protection. And so you go from there, and you, everyone down the line has to understand what their job is. So because of my 30-plus years of experience at all levels of law enforcement, I think that makes me the most qualified.
Thank you. It's 7:30. I still have a lot of questions for Sheriff, so I'd like you to stick around for a while. I'm not shutting it down or anything, but if anybody would like to leave, I'm sure that I understand and the community understands it is a long drive. So I'd like to offer you that. No, you don't even settle down over there. You all want to stay? Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
So what I was thinking is, why don't we give our ending?
No, I've got a few more station questions.
Well, no, then if everybody wants to leave.
No, not everybody. These people are staying. They're the ones.
Okay. Well, I didn't want everybody running out the door.
So. They'll leave what they want.
I was just making a suggestion.
Trust me, that's the way we work things down here. So just give me the opportunity. I know it's a long drive. No one's running. I like it. We've got a good group here. Thank you. Who am I at again? Friends?
Mark, I lost track. I'm sorry.
I live in Ruth. What can we do about a much quicker response time to E911 calls? It's a question. I understand it. I understand. You can only get from here to there.
Response times are a result of proximity of deputies.
Yeah.
Whether it's an E911 or a telephone 911, that is irrelevant. It's going to be the closer the deputy is, the faster he can respond. Our current situation, the deputies have to come from a long ways away to take their time.
Okay, thank you. Loaded question, Ron.
Yeah, if there's a deputy here, it's going to be a quick response time. If the deputy's somewhere else, it's going to take forever. And that just seems to be the way it is currently. I want to change that. You know, I want the deputy that lives in Ruth, where you put it, to be here, so there isn't going to be that response time. Because, he has to drive from Hayfork or Weaverville, wherever they're pulling him to now. And that is something that I'm going to take very seriously to reduce that call time.
Okay, thank you, candidate. Saxon.
It comes down to staffing. That's like we all said. If you don't have a deputy available, you're going to get the closest one, which could be Weaverville, could be Lewiston. We just don't know. I plan on working very, very hard to ensure that we can get additional personnel and get those resident deputies assigned to locations. On the E911 call, what I want to do is also further build on the coalition between all the other allied agencies, law enforcement that work in this county. Because you as a citizen, when that E911 call goes out, you don't really care who shows up as long as somebody with a badge and a gun is there to take care of you. Working with the Highway Patrol, working with Forest Service, CAL FIRE, any law enforcement agency out there that's available to respond, that's what I would be working towards, to see whether or not we can build a nice, strong relationship to have them go until we can get the deputy to handle the call.
Thank you. Deputy Sheriff Hanover, what is the biggest need in the Sheriff's Department, and what would you do to change it?
Well, I think at this point, we need more deputies. I mean, that is probably the biggest need. And to fix that problem, we got to have more money. And that is something very, very hard to get. There's not a lot of grants that are specific to just hiring deputies. We are working on a couple projects that I'm not at liberty to announce at this time to get funding for additional deputies.
Candidate Saxon.
What
is the biggest need in the sheriff's department, and what would you do to change it?
Within the sheriff's department, we do need more deputies on the road. So we all agree on that. I think a very close second on that, though, is training opportunities for the personnel within the department. Training opportunities, again, it encourages better morale, because I think when people have the opportunity to get additional training, they feel good about themselves and more confident about handling various types of calls that are out there. And to do that, my plan for that is, since I'm already a retired highway patrol captain, I'm going to opt out of PERS if elected, which means the county will not be spending money towards my PERS retirement because I won't be taking one. I'm going to ask that that money be put into a training fund for the Sheriff's Department for the uniform staff and the civilian staff to get as much training as we possibly can out of that.
Thank you very much. Deputy Sheriff Hanover, you brought up money. I need to ask a question of all of you. Start with candidate Saxon. Ron brought up money. Do you know where your revenue stream comes from to fund your department from it within the county? Beyond what? I'm sorry. Thank you. You want to answer that one? The other one. What is the biggest need in the sheriff's department, and what would you do to change it?
Obviously funding, but I would try something different than what we've been trying for the last 20 years.
Okay.
Try to get more grants.
Right.
Because that's all I've seen with that is a precipitous decline and demand on it.
Okay. Thank you. Moving to Tim, with the revenue stream that the sheriff's department gets, do you know where it comes from and how that process works? And can you explain it to me briefly, just in the items of how it works?
Approximately 38% of the general fund budget goes into the sheriff's department, and that's to fund patrol operations as well as the jail operations. The number one priority for a sheriff in California is to operate and maintain the detention facility. So that, a lot of money comes from that. There are various grants that are also already applied for. There are state grants, there are federal grants. The U.S. Forest Service gives an amount of money also to fund drug operations within the forest. That's in a nutshell, that's it.
Deputy Sheriff Potts.
Yes, I do. I actually have a breakdown of financial officers who provide what we have to
have. Okay, so
a breakdown of every single grant that we get, every source of funding. I currently don't have it with me, but yes, about 2% right this year is coming from the federal government, and I don't remember the breakdowns, but I have it all. I understand what it's coming from now.
Thank you. I probably didn't present the question well off the top of my head. Ron?
Yeah, I have the same information that Mark received from our business manager.
Who pays your salary?
My
Tim, if you're elected sheriff.
The people pay my salary.
Okay. Do you know where that revenue directly comes from?
General fund. The taxes.
Thank
property
you.
Property taxes.
Ron?
Yes. I couldn't say exactly where it comes from. I know it comes from the county.
Okay. Okay, Deputy Sheriff Potts, what's your plan to provide better law enforcement services in Southern Trinity? We're going over a few things here, but I'm digging for answers.
A lot of it will be limited by the resources
right.
And the deputies that we have, but until additional funding can become available in the interim, I've been amassing a posse, which now stands at over the last count of 400 souls, who are going to shore up some of the deficiencies and the lack of manpower that we have at the sheriff's office. And I'm going to utilize that source to shore up the lack of manpower until funding does.
Ron, what is your plan to better law enforcement services in Southern Trinity?
Well, at this point in time, no, there's nothing I can do about it. I know what my intentions are and where I want to go, but until I get there and start looking into what we have, where we can shave costs, and get this additional funding, I can't give you a really good answer right now how I'm going to get additional deputies in this south end of the county.
Okay. Candidate, you have a response to this one. What is your plan to better law enforcement services in Southern Trinity?
What I'm looking at is number one, having a greater presence in each community of neighborhood watch programs. Neighborhood watch programs that are served by on a regular basis by a deputy. In fact, I have a plan to get reserve deputies on board who already have knowledge of law enforcement techniques and protection of the public, and have them meet with neighborhood watch groups, as well as expanding the Trinity Sheriff's Auxiliary. I'd like to see them expand, get more people in more parts of the county that can be eyes and ears for law enforcement. As is already talked about, it's a money issue right now, getting enough people, enough deputies to be out there on the road to respond in a timely manner. But if we can get more concerned citizens to help out, I think that's the short-term answer.
Thank you. All three of you have answered that one, right? Thank you very much. Let's start with, you're the only one there. Candidate, what will be your policy on marijuana?
Well, the people of California voted to legalize the adult use of marijuana, and we've had medical use for several years. The county has a set of ordinances that are based upon the state regulations that, unfortunately, keep changing from time to time. But those ordinances are laws. They're in place. My feeling on it is if you want to abide by being a cultivator or a distributor or a manufacturer, you go through the process, you pay your license fees, you get your license, you become compliant, and you take care of business. And if you don't, then you're violating the law, and my position on that is you need to be taken care of appropriately, whether it be arrest, whether it be investigation, whether it be the civil side of it, the criminal side of it, that some action needs to be taken against those who are doing it illegally.
Canada, pause.
I will protect the property rights of the people pursuant to the Fourth Amendment of the U.S. Constitution.
Thank you. Canada, that.
I will enforce the laws of the state of Canada.
Okay, thank you. Most of these questions really relate back to what are you going to do for Southern Trinity? And I don't know how to make them tell us that they're going to provide an incredible service, that we're going to have 5 or 6 offices down here, let alone sub-offices or anything else. I have to really thank you all for being very upfront and honest.
Yes.
And
yes,
letting
yes.
us know that we're still kind of on our own, but maybe not, but you still will try.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. They're coming after you, Canada Potts. I'm sorry. These are just for you, Mark. You published many letters dealing with your beliefs on abolishing gun laws, abolishing county code enforcement, your view on drugs that don't create injured parties. Is that did I say that the right way? For your view on drugs that don't create injured parties? I don't understand it either, so sorry about that. Only dealing with marijuana grown on federal lands, the unrestricted right to do whatever you please on your property, and promoting jury nullification, all of which greatly benefit organized crime cartels, huge marijuana grows, drug dealers, and bad neighbors, while at the same time it would devastate our way of life, our families, our communities, and our environment. Why do you think that a sheriff with those beliefs would make our community safer? Before you answer that, I do want to apologize for this question. It has a lot of political overtones and assumptions. So don't take it personally. But answer it if you wish. If not, tell me to go and stuff it. And I understand that too.
As a sheriff, I do not have the discretion to pick and choose which laws I enforce, which laws I do not enforce. However, I am sworn allegiance to the United States Constitution to protect the property rights of the people. And it doesn't go much further than that. And until at such point, I think we need a good, what we need to do is a good application of what's referred to as the non-aggression principle. And what that means, what that philosophy means is, you're free to do as you please, pursue happiness as articulated in the Declaration of Independence, up until such point as you commit an act of aggression upon the person or the property of another. And that's a pretty simple concept, and unfortunately we're not following it right now. We have too many people that want to tell other people what they should be doing and what they shouldn't be doing, what they should be drinking, what they can't drink, what they can smoke, what they should consume, and what they can do on their property, ask permission to throw a building on the property, which absolutely flips on its head the whole idea of private property. It's not private property anymore. You have to ask permission to conduct activities on the said property. It's just as simple as that.
Thank you, Ken. It's only been about 15 minutes. I'm running out of questions. Anybody have anything else they'd like to stand up? Yes.
How do you guys feel on the concealed weapons permit?
Regarding concealed weapons, do you want to, let's start with Deputy Hanover.
Yeah, I'm all for the concealed weapons. I will continue the current process and honor any concealed weapon permits that have been issued.
Tim?
I believe in the CCW program. I believe that if you get the training and you make the application process and you sit down and have the interview and I find everything checks out well, by golly, you get it. The other thing on that, though, is I encourage people that if they're going to get a CCW, to also get the training to go along with that firearm that you plan on carrying. There's nothing worse than if they have a gun, you have the CCW, and something happens and you don't know how to use it. In my opinion, that's worthless to even have it. But I plan on honoring the existing CCWs that are out there and having an active role in approving new ones. And also looking at the administrative costs right now. There's certain costs that the state of California has in place for a CCW, and then there's administrative costs that are tied on top of that. And I would like to take a look at those costs at the agency level to see whether or not those can be reduced in any way to help the people in the county.
Mark?
For me, constitutional carry is the order of the day. I have no discretion to do otherwise. I've sworn an oath of allegiance to the Constitution of the United States of America, and that dictates that you have the right to keep and possess and bear arms. I will, however, for those who go outside of our jurisdiction, continue the process of permitting so that the people that do carry outside of my jurisdiction will be covered in other jurisdictions.
Okay. Thank you. And thank you, Ben. That's really important. I didn't know I could lose that right, that option. Any other questions? Okay, who would like to...
There's a question over here.
Right. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, Mike.
As we lose more and more of our rights to the federal government, as we lose our, you know, protections, how do you feel about protecting us as a sheriff against the federal government and those loss of rights? Because you guys are the last stop. It's your job.
That's a really broad question in my mind. It encompasses a lot of different things when you say laws.
I'm talking about our rights, our general rights, you know, as citizens, that the right to privacy, the right to our Fourth Amendment rights have eroded, protection of property rights, protection of the gun rights.
I believe in due process. I believe that the Fourth Amendment should be followed in any type of law enforcement agency. As the sheriff, I believe in enforcing the laws equally across the board. Now, if you're saying the federal government comes in and says, Sheriff, now you have to do ABC, I'm going to take a look at ABC and see whether or not that's the best thing for my people in this county, the people that I'm sworn to protect. And if it's not, then I'm going to tell them, sorry, no, we're not going to do it. If I see that it's something that would be of benefit to help the people to be safer, then I'll probably be inclined to do that. But I really think we're just talking kind of conceptually here, right. And that's how I would look at it.
Thank you, Martin.
It's the sheriff's duty to interpose on behalf of the people against the tyrannical government, no matter what level, whether it's a federal, state, or county level government. If they're abusing the rights of the citizens, it's the sheriff's duty to interpose and stop that.
Yeah, I think these guys said it all. I'm not going to add any more to that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any additional questions? Well, we got them here. Other thing I would suggest is they did hang around, so nab them afterwards after they give their closing statement. Also, I'm sure all of them will be more than willing to meet with you personally or get on the phone or anything like that. And that goes for all the candidates. Who wants to start with your closing statement? That's fine.
AI?
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
Okay. Go ahead. Thanks again for being here tonight. Really appreciate it. It's a good turnout. You know, I can't tell you how happy I am just to have the opportunity to run for sheriff here. Living here for 20 years, I've seen a lot of things that happen, a lot of good things, some bad things. I want to take the opportunity I have with my 30 plus years of experience at all levels of law enforcement ranks, as well as within the state and the federal level, to bring my knowledge to do as much as I can to protect you, the people of Trinity County. As I said, my family's here, they came back here, they're going to stay here, they're going to raise their families here. I want to do everything I possibly can to make this a better place for them to grow up so that when their fourth generation is here, they're going to say, hey, this is a cool place to live and I really love it here. I encourage you to become involved in all of our backgrounds, all of our qualifications, make an informed decision for the next election, and pick who you think can truly lead the Sheriff's Department into the future, the next 5 to 10 years, and make a difference in Trinity County. So thank you very much.
Okay, you've still got a couple more minutes to go.
I don't need any more. I think that's it.
Okay. Yeah, Rock. Okay. Go between yourselves.
You're halfway there.
No, just keep everything that you have holstered.
I think we've pretty much said a lot of what needed to be said, and you've got a pretty good idea. Me personally, I know, based on some of the questions, a lot of you know a lot about me from my writings in the paper over the years, and that's not a new thing. So a lot of people already know where I'm coming from and what I believe and my political beliefs. Some people agree, some people disagree. That's what the election process is all about. So I'm glad people came out, and you can see the guys that are running, and you can make your choice. Candidacy is much different than the other two gentlemen running. I come from a different perspective, so I give the people that choice.
Thank you. Ron?
Okay.
Isn't this fun? You all wanted to do this. I
know.
Everyone at this table.
We're crazy.
Yes. I'll include myself in that.
As the next sheriff, it is my desire to be a sheriff for the people of proactive sheriff, a sheriff that is willing to continue working in the field, a sheriff that will lead from the front lines, a sheriff that will stay in touch with the community and will remain ever vigilant and staying an active part of each community. As sheriff, I will protect and defend our Second Amendment right. I will continue to work with local and state agencies to combat our county's environmental issues. Leadership is a critical part of law enforcement. With my leadership and experience and the help of the men and women of the sheriff's office, we will focus on the goals that I have set out to combat. I have the leadership, experience, and training needed to lead the sheriff's office into the future. My promise, I will be a proactive sheriff for the people. I will be a proactive sheriff. I will always strive to make Trinity County a better, safer place to live, visit, and to raise our families. I will always be honest and sincere. I will always do my best to serve and protect our citizens. You are the people who will elect me as your sheriff. As sheriff, I will do what the people would have me do. What it comes down to is, what do you really want? It is to feel safe in your home and in the community. And I have the training and experience, the knowledge of what the communities need and want. And I thank you guys for coming out tonight.
Thank you. I want to thank all of you for coming down here tonight. I know it's a long drive, and we do pick you up. You didn't get your finals letter?
Yes, we did.
Sandy, you've been running this whole darn thing.
He's loaded on cookies.
What? Yeah, really. Oh, there are cookies in back of coffee. This is an incredible turnout for people running in Trinity County for elected offices. I can't thank these candidates enough, and just thank you. Have a safe drive home, and please approach them, talk to them personally, get their phone number, arrange in-house cookie, coffee, whatever you can, so you can find out. Get them back down here. Take them out on the lake.
And there are papers from them over on that table that people can pick up. Badges, papers.
Thank you. Absolutely.